carts here, the ones that I'm on, and the middle and the one over there, will go onto the stage proper. These lifts will lower, and all of this open space, the literal house, will be the playing space, with entrances here and here. So it will be a very, very different way of configuring the style as well as what we're doing spatially in the structure. So I'm looking forward to it.
Your hair's all over the place. Here, here's a comb.
Can I pause? Can I see a different level for Berger since he's hung over? Can I see him either in a chair or...
That means that you will absolutely need a 30-second to 1 minute.
Get right in there.
No. Need your lines to be cold. Okay, so that means you need to do the extra work, even though it's hard this week, even though you've got school starting, to get it done.
Oh, I got this!
From Orson Welles took the form of an apology to the audience, opening night, April 1960, at the Royal Court Theatre in London, where his production of Rhinoceros by Eugene Ionesco was premiering. For you see, director Welles was kicked out of his own theatrical process by the famous English actor, Sir Laurence Olivier, who had inspired the cast against Mr. Welles and confronted him within a rehearsal. Welles, humiliated, never returned to the rehearsal process until the technical rehearsals, where the theater production had changed venues and casts. Since Mr. Welles was also set, costume, lighting, and sound designer of the show, he returned to the technical rehearsals to find Olivier's interpretation was completely different. With no time to change these elements, Welles rigged up a microphone, sat there, apologized to the audience for the experience of theater never being complete, and then proceeded to give lighting directions and instructions to the actors. Louder, louder, take down the music. Now, lift the curtain, now, now! More rhino roars, that's it! As a practitioner in the art of theater, celebrating 20 years on this very stage, I can certainly agree with Mr. Welles. In fact, his story inspired our process and what you'll see tonight. The experience of theater is never complete. This is table work. This is where we start as an ensemble. The rehearsal where you literally sit, read, and listen to the play. This is where we begin. The actors become investigators of the play's mysteries, where we learn that Beringer is Beringer, and Jean is Jean. This is our process. This is Rhinoceros.
Don't even bat an eyelid. It shouldn't be allowed. Put your hand in front of your mouth.
Right. It shouldn't be allowed. It's dangerous. I hadn't realized, but don't worry about it. It won't get us here.
We ought to protest at the town council. What's the council there for?
Excuse me.
Make sure to keep moving, Chaz, because you'd be blocking audience there.
Perhaps the rhinoceros escaped from the zoo.
You're daydreaming. Never talked nonsense in my life!
Trying to be philosophic about it.
You're just a pretentious show-off. A pedant.
Now, gentlemen.
And what's more, a pedant who's not certain of his facts. Because in the first place, it's the Asiatic rhinoceros with only one horn on his nose, and it's the African with two.
No, it's the other way about.
He was so sweet.
Or not.
It's all an infamous plot.
It's all your fault.
No! My mind rather than yours.
Mine? It's always the bigger people that get on the plane.
If I had my... Take away!
Here I am, a freshman in my second show where I have more than one line. And we find out that it's in an alley, and I'm... That's cool. I love alleys. I didn't think it was going to be an actual alley where the audience is on stage. I grew up traditionally in normal plays that I consider, and the actors are on stage, and the audience is in the audience. This is not what I thought I was getting when I signed up for this. It's new, crazy, insane, but I love it. I'm so happy that this has happened to me. I've learned a lot from it. And I enjoy it.
Pull out the ladder!
I will be king all the time. I'm following.
Come in.
Hello, John.
Bunny, I didn't recognize your voice.
I didn't recognize yours either.
Sit down.
You know, John, it was stupid of me to get so upset yesterday over a thing like that.
Thing like what?
Yesterday.
When yesterday? Where yesterday?
Don't you remember? It was about that wretched rhinoceros.
What rhinoceros?
The rhinoceros, or rather the two wretched rhinoceroses we saw.
Oh, yes, I remember. How do you know they were wretched?
Oh, I just said that.
Oh, well, let's not talk any more about it.
Very nice.
Well, then that's that. I don't feel very well.
That's probably why you're in bed. You know, John, as it turned out, we were both right.
Just win. Because I felt like it.
Do you know what happened to Buff?
What happened to Buff?
He's turned into a rhinoceros. Come on now, stop joking.
Nature!
Nature?
Nature has its own laws! Morality's against nature!
Are you suggesting we replace our moral laws by the laws of the jungle?
Me fine.
You say that, but deep down, no one...
We've got to build our lives on new foundations. We must get back to primeval integrity.
Just think a moment. You must admit that we have a philosophy that animals don't share, and an irreplaceable set of values, which has taken centuries of human civilization to build up.
And once we demolished all that, we'll be better off.
You don't believe that. You know as well as I do that mankind...
Don't talk to me.
I mean the human individual, humanism.
Humanism is all washed up.
You really must be out of your mind. You wouldn't like to be a rhinoceros now, would you?
Why not? I'm not a victim of prejudice like you.
Can you speak more clearly? I didn't catch that. You swallowed the words.
Then keep your ears open!
What?
Keep your ears open, I said. What's wrong with being a rhinoceros? I'm all for change.
You mustn't get into such a state. Calm down. I hardly recognize you anymore. What are you doing? You're not yourself. You're normally so modest. Can you hear me any longer? Can't you hear me?
I can hear you perfectly well. I can see you perfectly well.
Watch out, sir! Calm down. I'm going to get the doctor. It's absolutely necessary. Please.
No!
Calm down, John. You're being ridiculous. You're a rhinoceros.
I'll throw you. I'll throw you down.
He's a rhinoceros. He's a rhinoceros. He's a rhinoceros.
I get so upset over a few cases of rhinoceritis.
Perhaps it's just another disease.
Exactly. And I'm afraid of catching it.
Stop thinking about it. Really, you attach too much importance to the whole business. John's case? No, that isn't symptomatic. He was far too excitable, and wild, and eccentric. You mustn't base your judgments on exceptions. It's the average case you must consider.
Yes, you're right. He must have been temporarily unbalanced. Yet he gave his reasons for it. He'd obviously given it a lot of thought and weighed the pros and cons. What about both then? Was he mad too? And what about all the others?
You can be sure that both and the others didn't do what they did. They became what they became just to annoy you. They wouldn't have gone through all that trouble.
It's true. That makes sense. It's a reassuring thought. Or, on the other hand, perhaps that makes it worse. There. Can you hear that?
No, why can't you leave them alone? They're not doing you any harm. Really, you're obsessed by them. It's not good for you. You're wearing yourself out. You just concentrate on getting back to normal.
I wonder if I really am immune.
In any case, it's not fatal.
But it's bound to have certain after effects. An organic upheaval like that can't help
but they're only temporary. Don't you worry.
You absolutely certain?
I think so. Yeah, yes, I suppose so. Not for me, thank you. I never touch it.
Alcohol is good for epidemics. It immunizes you. It kills influenza microbes, for instance.
Perhaps it doesn't kill all microbes. They don't know about rhinoceritis yet. You see? You can't take it. It makes you cough.
There wasn't anything odd about it, was there? It was a real human cough.
What are you getting at? Of course it was an ordinary human cough. What other cough could it have been?
I don't know. Perhaps an animal's cough? Do rhinoceroses cough?
Look, Baron Jay, you're being ridiculous. You invent difficulties for yourself. You ask yourself the weirdest questions. I remember you said before, the best protection against the thing was willpower.
Yes, I did.
Well, then prove you've got some.
Doing it quite deliberately. When the epidemic's over, then I shall stop drinking.
Oh, you're making excuses for yourself.
You really think so? You think that's how the rot sets in? I'm not an alcoholic.
Look, you've gotten over your shock completely. You can get out there for a breath of fresh air, you'll feel better, you'll see. All these morbid ideas will vanish.
Go out? I suppose I'll have to. I'm dreading the moment. I'll be bound to meet some of them.
And what if you do? They don't attack you. You just leave them alone, they ignore you. You can't say they're spiteful. They've even got a certain natural innocence to them, a sort of frankness. Besides, I walked right along the avenue to get here, and I arrived safe and sound, didn't I? No trouble at all.
Just the sight of them upsets me. It's a nervous thing, but it does something to me here. I get a tight feeling inside.
You've no sense of humor. That's your trouble, not at all. You must learn to be more detached and try and see the funny side.
Feel responsible for everything that happens. I just can't feel indifferent.
Judge not, lest ye be judged. If you go on worrying about everything, you'll never be able to start living.
Maybe it happened somewhere else in some other country, and we just read about it in the papers. One could discuss it quietly, examine the questions from all points of view, and come to an objective conclusion. We could organize debates with professors and writers and lawyers and blue stockings and artists and people. And the ordinary man in the street as well would be very interesting and instructive. When you're involved yourself, when you suddenly find yourself up against the brutal facts, you can't help feeling directly concerned. The shock is too violent for you to stay cool and detached. Frankly surprised. I'm very, very surprised. I can't get over it.
Well, I'm surprised too. Or rather, I was. I'm starting to get used to it.
But don't you agree it's all very unfortunate?
I don't say it's a good thing. Please don't start to get the idea that I'm on.
You mustn't do that. Think of the risk. Don't let him go. He mustn't go.
I'd like him to stay, but people must do as they please.
The man is superior to the rhinoceros.
I didn't say he wasn't. I'm not with you absolutely either. I don't know. Only experience can tell. I feel certain scruples. I feel it's my duty to stick by my friends and my employers through thick and thin.
It's not as if you were married to them.
I've renounced marriage. I prefer the great universal family rather than the little domestic one.
We shall miss you a lot, Dudar. He's very good-hearted.
He's too good-hearted. You're too good-hearted. You're human. Don't let him go. He's making a mistake. He's human.
What can I do?
Come back, Dudar. We're fond of you. Don't go.
We couldn't do anything. You could defend me? What's happening?
Taking over the radio stations. Sorry. I'm not going to quarrel with their attempts.
They're like gods.
Cars and drive away, you probably talk about the show and you ask yourself questions. Do you ever question what we do as actors when the show is over? How we have to readjust ourselves to being who we are? For someone like me, who's played everything from a serial killer to a giant murderous plant to a pirate, I'm going to pose a question for all of you.
Who are you all? Are you the real you that sits before us? Are you all simply actors pretending to be these people before us? Or are you, am I, are we just rhinoceros?
Come down.
Light's changing.
Thank you, Eli. Miss Cindy.
Here's a final example of a syllogism. At the end of the show, the audience leaves. It's the end of the show, therefore, scat! Come on, get out! What are y'all doing here? God.